OK, time for us to take a look at this morning's back pages in today's paper talk. And delighted to say that joining us today is the Northern Football Correspondent for the Daily Telegraph, Luke Edwards, and broadcaster Sophie Nicolaou. Very good morning to you both. Let's dive right into it then, shall we? And a lot of back pages this morning focusing on that huge FA Cup fourth round tie between Manchester City and Arsenal. And the Mirror is going with "it's gonna kick off," as Pep Guardiola says it's only a matter of time before he clashes with Arsenal boss Mikel Arteta. Sophie, we know both these managers are quite animated on the sideline, that they're full of praise for each other in the build-up to the game, though. Do you think any niceties between the two will all go out of the window come kick-off?
Yeah, I mean, niceties go out of the window when we play our mates at darts or golf. So imagine what these two are thinking. And also, Pep said in this article, the last time they spoke was to wish each other a happy Christmas and, a good holiday season. So I think that's about it in terms of the niceties. The Pep coaching tree is growing as well. You've got Xavi, company, Mikel Arteta, all very passionate, learned from the master himself. And I don't think anyone other than Richard Keys really cares about touchline behaviour. Fans are loving the passion. There's rivalry. Pep needed, I think, this challenge from the Arsenal this season, especially Liverpool not doing so great, Chelsea not doing so well. So I think this has added a little spice and flavour to the occasion. And Arsenal being back has ignited a football fire for a lot of people. And I think Pep is using that as fuel to motivate himself, as great a manager as he is.
Yeah, in terms of both their passion as well, Pep Guardiola goes on to say in this interview, I taught him a few things in terms of Mikel Arteta, but it all comes from himself, from his family. He's sort of so passionate about football, just generally. Luke, this match is very much being billed as the master versus the apprentice. Arteta has spoken about the influence of Pep Guardiola on his coaching style. What similarities or differences do you see in the way that the two sides are set up?
I think there's a similar intensity to their play. I don't think they play tactically exactly the same way by any means, but I think they, it's interesting. I think when Eddie Howe, the Newcastle United manager, played them, he likened Arsenal to Man City Mark II. And I think there is that. They get in your face. They try and dominate the ball. They try and push you further and further back. I know a lot of Arsenal fans are complaining about teams playing with a low block against them now, but it's just so difficult to get the ball off Arsenal, and they come at you from all angles. I think with Saka and Martinelli on the wings, they're incredibly dangerous. I think Partey and Granit Xhaka in the middle give them a really, really nice balance. So we've got this strange quirk of fate, though, haven't we, that the two best teams in the country, and I do think Arsenal and Manchester City are the two best teams in the country. I don't think many people would disagree with me. They haven't actually played each other yet, so that makes this a sort of clash this weekend even more appetizing, really.
Yeah, that is just it, isn't it? They haven't played each other yet this season. They've got this FA Cup tie this evening, then they play each other twice in the league in the space of just a few weeks. So it's a proper litmus test, really, tonight, isn't it? Sophie, I mean, I know you've got a little bit of bias perhaps, but who do you see coming out on top?
The big question for Arsenal fans is, would you win tonight or take 3 points on February 15th? And the point is great in terms of these two teams being the best right now, and we haven't even played each other. I fancy a draw tonight. How about that?
Very, very diplomatic of you, Luke. How about you?
I think Man City have got to make some sort of statement. I think Pep Guardiola has been displeased, shall we say, to put it politely, with some of their performances recently. So I think they need to pull something out of the hat. So I'm going to go with a Man City win.
OK, well, we'll see which one of you is right tomorrow, won't we? Let's move on and look at Everton's search for Frank Lampard's successor. That's the lead story on the back of the Daily Mail this morning, along with a picture of Marcelo Bielsa arriving in England. The reporting is that he is the favourite to take the job at Goodison Park. As you can see, he arrived in England yesterday ahead of more meetings regarding taking over at Everton. I mean, Luke, looks as though Bielsa is now the favourite for the role, despite the fact that he reportedly needs a little bit more convincing to accept the job offer. So it's not straightforward at this point.
No, far from straightforward. I don't think many things with Marcelo Bielsa are straightforward. I think if we can predict one thing about him, it is unpredictability. I think even though he's flown into London to talk to Everton, on one hand, that is encouraging. But I think all the sort of noise around it is that he still needs to be persuaded, I think his initial assessment of the squad, that it was too slow. He's never taken over a club before in the middle of a season because Bielsa's methods and approach, he always feels he needs that pre-season period to get his players up to speed. And he certainly did that at Leeds United on his first job in England. I think what it tells us is that Bielsa would like to stay in the Premier League. And it is an intriguing club, but for all the mess they're in, Everton, for all the trouble they're currently going for all the animosity towards the owner and that sort of toxicity of the situation at the moment, they are still a fantastic football club and a big football club. And Bielsa will be appealed to that. It's a wounded beast, as it were, Everton. So he will fancy that. I still think, but also you get this idea that you've got a face-off between Bielsa and Sean Dyche. If that doesn't show you how confused the thinking is in the Goodison Park boardroom in terms of what they need to get them out of trouble, I don't know. They're kind of polar opposites, really, Sean Dyche and Bielsa as managers. So we'll have to wait and see. I certainly wouldn't be calling it a safe bet that Bielsa ends up at Goodison Park. I really wouldn't.
Okay, well, so Sophie, how do you see that fit of Bielsa at Everton? Because like Luke says, usually he likes to come in with a long period of preparation to get a team playing his way and also just the intensity in which he plays. So do you think he could be a success there, given the situation they're in and coming in midway through a season?
I mean, this is a really tough one because Everton Football Club is so broken and it feels like they've just continually put band-aids on a bad situation that runs deeper. Everton fans shamelessly as well being thrown under the bus by the board. There's just so much turmoil there. So if a manager comes in, we've seen Ancelotti fail, we've seen Benitez fail. They went for the younger manager in Lampard. Yeah, he failed. You could go back to Martinez days and look at maybe that David Moyes kept that club together in so many different ways. People didn't even realise until now. Bielsa is a fantastic manager. Maybe Everton need that intensity right now, someone who can come in. The players have been hiding as well. They're not immune to criticism. And maybe they need something like that. And see, filed under Leeds United. Yes, in the end, it was too much. And what, you know, his style can take its toll. But right now, I think Everton need a manager who can come in with a clear identity and make these players work harder than they ever have. The fans deserve it. I feel for the Everton fans.
OK, let's stay with Everton and turn our attention to the Daily Telegraph, which is reporting this morning, which we've been talking about this a lot. Anthony Gordon missed Everton training for a third day yesterday, the second that was sort of unplanned, having had an agreed day off on Tuesday. So it looks as though he's trying to engineer a move to Newcastle. I mean, Luke, there's a lot on this in your paper on the Daily Telegraph this morning. What's the latest, as we know, with this deal then? Newcastle seem increasingly confident that they can prize Gordon away from Everton. Can a deal be done here?
I think a deal can be done. And I think Anthony Gordon is certainly playing his part in trying to make that happen. I think he's made his feelings abundantly clear now to Everton. That is naturally going to drop the asking price. I think Newcastle have been confident since the middle of the week, really. They will have had talks with his representatives. They know that Anthony Gordon wants to come. You know, the fee has to be right. I still think there is some way to go. There is some negotiations to happen, but we've seen many, many times before in a January transfer window, and I certainly have, they become quite exhausting the closer we get to the finishing line. So I think this is one of those deals that could still go down to the wire. I don't think Newcastle want to go much over 40 million, personally. How much they pay up front is still to be discussed. There'll be certain add-ons to the deal. So there's a lot still to be done. But I think Newcastle are fairly relaxed about the situation, which is unusual for this stage. So I think that probably tells you that they have some confidence that Everton eventually are going to have to sell for a fee closer to their valuation of the player.
Yeah, and ultimately would put some cash in the pocket for a new manager. Sophie, in regards to Everton, I mean, Luke's already sort of said, you know, with the fact they've got Bielsa and Sean Dyche as the two sort of leading candidates to take over as manager, then you've got this going on with a player not turning up to train and sort of engineer a move. I mean, it sort of sums up the situation the club is in at the moment, doesn't it? With the transfer window closing on Tuesday, they kind of need, how badly do they need to resolve all of these situations?
I don't think they're going to resolve anything in this transfer window. Acquiring players is one thing, but having someone who can come in with a plan, you know, is another. And again, you know, Everton's issue has started off the pitch and then has just seeped onto the pitch. And this has been going on for a long time and it's been ignored. And I don't think one transfer window, Hannah, is going to be able to fix that for this team. There's a long road ahead and there might be more pain before the solution is actually found. And, you know, my club, Arsenal, we've been through the pain. You know, we flirted with relegation a couple of seasons ago, but at the very beginning, it's painful and it's difficult. And you have to see what it takes in order to just clean house. They need to clean house and start from scratch. And that is not an easy thing to do in modern day football, where instant gratification is everything.
But it can be done, can't it, Sophie? Luke, Sophie, thank you very much for your time this morning. Brilliant to have you with us on Paper Talk.
Thanks.